The Gospel according to Mark, chapter 5. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains. But he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had strength to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him. And crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send him out of the country. Now a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. The herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country, and people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had had the legion, sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and to the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. And when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years, who had suffered much under many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment, for she said, "If I touch even his garments, I will be made well." And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, "Why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha, kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age, and they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and he told them to give her something to eat.
You're not going to believe this, but Friday, I got into a fight. Okay, you're laughing. No, seriously, and just to show you the scar, I'd like the cameras to zoom in. Okay, you see that? Stubborn opponent. It was crazy, this bush in front of our house. And I'm trying to trim it, and it just gashed me really big. You know, the things that we go through in life, and we laugh about a bush, but some of us facing pretty desperate situations. I want to tell you the story of something I went through in my life. I was about 10 years old, and on a Sunday, January 16th, on a Sunday, we lived in the Dominican Republic. My parents are missionaries. My mom's here today. My brother Terry's here today with his family. And Terry and I were going to work on a basketball backstop at our house, and we climbed up on the roof of the house, a brick home, and we're up there and pounding nails on this thing, and a nail flipped and hit me right in my right eye, tore into my eye. And my brother Terry freaked out. He jumped off the roof. Guess he landed okay, and I went to the back and climbed down the way we'd come up. My folks were like, "Whoa, what happened?" And anything that happens with your eyes, you know, is serious. 10-year-old boy. And I remember getting into our old Volkswagen. Mom, you remember that? Our old Volkswagen. Dad was driving crazy, getting me to the hospital. I was sitting in the front seat. Mom's in the back seat. And it dawned on me that this was a situation that was beyond my parents' ability to control. Mom was praying in the back seat, and as I was sitting there realizing, wow, this is pretty serious, don't know what's gonna happen, hospitals and doctors aren't that great overseas, this is a long time ago, and I just began to draw near to the Lord. As a young man, this is a major marker in my life. So it wasn't mom and dad's religion now. It was mine. It was my relationship with Jesus. The 23rd Psalm came to my heart and mind. The Lord is my shepherd. And spent over a week in the hospital. They sewed up my eye. They were able to save it. I've never been able to see very well out of that eye since. But talk about a desperate situation. Well, we are studying in the Gospel of Mark and our series, Servant King. And I hope you have your Bibles and your highlighters today, because we're going to highlight some things, but we're going to just look at what the Bible has to say to us. We've been looking in Mark, and you'll recall that the big idea of this series, remember this with me, believe in Jesus and live it out. So as we go through the book of Mark every week, and today is chapter 5, as they announced earlier, we want to see what does this reveal to us about Jesus, and then how can we live this out? In chapter 1, and Professor Mark, he spoke to us from chapter 1, is this call to know and follow Jesus. And the testimony of John the Baptist, remember that? And there are miracles and there are crowds and the calling of the first disciples. And then in Mark chapter 2, and my brother Tom, Pastor Tom spoke, and he told us about the authority of Jesus. Remember? Authority to heal, but also authority to forgive sins. And he even has authority over traditions and over the Sabbath. That was a powerful message that we learned about Jesus. In chapter 3, Pastor Garrett talked about the hardness of hearts. Boy, we had to check our own hearts, didn't we? Are there times when we grow hard in our hearts to the things of the Lord. And some people in that day, especially the religious rulers, were beginning to question Jesus and come against him. In fact, when we look at chapter 1, there was curiosity about Jesus and crowds are gathering. And then in chapter 2, they're beginning to question him a little bit and, well, wait, you know, you can't forgive sins and all of this stuff. But then in chapter 3, I mean, it's outright opposition. They're plotting to kill him. They just want to kill him. And then last week, Pastor Ted spoke to us in chapter 4, and it shows us this master teacher, Jesus. He's teaching the people using stories. We call them parables, and teaching about the kingdom of God and spiritual things and the soil of our hearts. I don't know how many of you got the little bag of soil last week and took it home with you. And now we come to chapter 5. In chapter 5, we learn about people who are in desperate situations. And I want to invite you right now, here in Auditorium 1, Auditorium 2, and if you're watching online, to open your heart to the Lord. What does God want to say to you this morning? Would you just open your heart with me? Let's just pray right now and ask God to speak to us. Father, take your word, plant it deep in our hearts like seed in good soil today. And cause something to grow in us that is what you want and something you want to do in our lives. I pray that in Jesus' name. Now, would you take your Bible in hand? If you have a paper Bible, hold that up. If you have an electronic version, hold that up. But let's say our Bible confession together. Say it with me. This is truth. This is life. This is God's word. Amen. Amen. So we get to chapter 5 of the Gospel of Mark. And here in chapter 5, we encounter four desperate situations. Now I'm fudging a little bit because I'm going back to the last part of chapter 4, which is the first of the four desperate situations. You know that the chapters and verses in the Bible were put in later. They weren't written with those things in. And so they just placed them a lot of times, making chapters about the same length and whatever. And so the story at the end of chapter 4 fits with the three stories that we're going to find in chapter 5. So four desperate situations. Let's review them quickly. First of all, the desperate situation of the flooding boat. You'll recall, and I'm going to read it to you. This is in chapter 4, the end. The disciples and Jesus get in the boat. These are fishermen. They know what they're doing. And it says, as evening came, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's cross to the other side of the lake." So they took Jesus in the boat and started out, leaving the crowds behind, although others' boats followed. But soon a fierce storm came up. High waves were breaking into the boat, and it began to fill with water. Jesus was sleeping at the back of the boat with his head on a cushion. The disciples woke him up, shouting, "Teacher, don't you care that we're going to drown?" When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Silence, be still." Suddenly the wind stopped and there was a great calm. Then he asked them, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" The disciples were absolutely terrified. "Who is this man?" they asked. "Even the wind and the waves obey him." So this first desperate situation, we have seasoned fishermen who are on the lake. We call it the Sea of Galilee. And the wind comes up and it's so desperate, the water's coming into the boat, they are saying, "We might drown." They're desperate. I don't know if you've ever been in a situation where you're fearing for your life. That's where these guys were. Jesus, he speaks to the wind and to the waves, and suddenly there's this great calm. That's what the scripture tells us. And here's the disciples' response. They're not high-fiving, "Hey, fist bumping, you know, oh, this is great." No, it tells us they were absolutely terrified. Take your highlighter and highlight that word, terrified. Verse 41, they were terrified. And you remember the two questions that Pastor Ted told us about last week. The first one was, teacher, don't you care if we're going to drown? And I want you to remember that, because we're coming back to it later. The second question is, who is this man? Who is this man? They're talking about Jesus. So here's what I want you to see in this first desperate situation. Jesus has control over nature. He told the wind and the waves, silence, be still. And they responded, and it grew calm. Let's go to the second desperate situation. As we heard read here before we began to speak, they get to the other side of the lake, the area of the Gerasenes, and there's this man, the Bible says, this demon-possessed man who just roamed naked in the tombs. He was away from people. They tried to bind him. They tried to chain him. He would scream and wail at night and all the time. He must have just been terrifying to people. And he cut himself, self-harm. All of this stuff was going on. He's demonized, as demonized as anyone can get. In fact, Jesus, when he's telling the spirits to come out of the man, he asked them their name, and remember what they said, Legion. Now, Legion represents a Roman group of soldiers, 6,000 infantry, 120 cavalry, and supporting special troops. That's what the demons are saying. We're a legion in here. Uncontrollable, separated from others, self-harming, tormented. I would say this is a desperate situation. And I want you to notice something. When they meet Jesus, these demons who scare everyone else are begging Jesus, please, don't torture us. I don't know what that means. I don't know if that was the thing that they did to demons or that Jesus did. They don't torture us. They're begging him. And then notice in verse 13, it says that Jesus gave them permission. Take your highlighter and highlight that word, permission, verse 13. He gives them permission to go into the pigs. There's 2,000 pigs, you know, that good Jewish people don't have pigs and they don't eat pig. But this is on the other side of the lake where it's more Gentile. It's called the 10 cities, the Decapolis, and it's very Gentile. They have pigs, and that's where the demons go. You know the story. They run down the hill, drowned in the lake. But Jesus gave them permission. Now here's the man who was in the desperate situation. He is delivered. He gets clothed, and it tells us that he's in his right mind. And people from all over come to see what's happened. The people who were tending the pigs, I was going to call them shepherds, but I think that's sheep. So they're tending the pigs, and they run over, and they're telling everyone, this is what happened, that demoniac guy and the pigs, and they come to see what's going on. And they see this man that had always terrified them, who roamed in the tombs and was naked and screaming and yelling and all this stuff all the time. And when they come and see him sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, how do you suppose they react? It tells us they were all afraid. They were all afraid. In fact, they're so afraid, they just say, please, Jesus, Rabbi, whoever you are, leave us. And so Jesus does. He gets in the boat. He's going to go. Now the man, he says, Jesus, I want to go with you. Don't leave me here. I want to go with you. And Jesus says, no, you go back to these 10 cities where you live, these Gentiles. You tell them all the things that God has done for you, what I have done for you. And so you know what he does? He does. He goes and he starts telling people all over that area what Jesus has done for him. So what I'm going to tell you now is that Jesus has control over demons. Okay? If you ever wonder, if you're ever watching some silly movie or whatever that shows something different, the truth is Jesus has control over demons. Now, the next thing that we see, and you remember what Professor Mark told us about the Markan sandwich? So throughout the book of Mark, there are times when Mark will start a story, it's interrupted with something in the middle, and then he comes back to it. And that's what we have here in chapter 5. Jairus comes for his daughter, and then it's interrupted by this woman who has an issue of blood, who's bleeding. And so then we go to that middle part, you could say the meat here, and then we come back to the other piece of bread and we finish it. And so here's the third desperate situation. It's a woman with a chronic condition. Now, for those of you who are young people, you probably are not all that familiar with a chronic condition. A chronic condition is something where you're in pain or there's something wrong, but the word chronic means it just keeps going on and on and on. It just stays with you. It's not like you're going to get better next week, or Addison, you know, your foot's going to be better in a few months and you won't have that boot on anymore. No, chronic means it just continues on. Here we have a woman who's in a desperate situation. 12 years she has been bleeding. She's tried and paid for all that the doctors could do, and it got worse. And not just the physical infirmity in this woman, but the shame that went with it, because she is ceremonially unclean. Anyone who touches her, or anyone who she touches, become unclean also. So she is pushed away from people. And this woman, in her desperation, thinks, if I can just touch Jesus' clothes, if I can just reach out and touch his garment, I can be healed. And so she pushes through the crowd. She wasn't supposed to be there, and she wasn't supposed to be touching people. But listen, this woman's desperate. And so she goes and presses through and touches Jesus' cloak. And immediately she feels that she's been healed. And she doesn't say anything. She doesn't shout and whoop or jump or do anything. But Jesus senses that some healing power has gone from him. And so he's looking around this crowded situation. The disciples are saying, Jesus, people, everyone's touching you. What are you talking about? But he's saying, someone touched me and there was healing. And finally, I want you to notice this woman comes. And in verse 33, it says she's a frightened woman, trembling. And she falls down before Jesus. Take your highlighter. And in verse 33, highlight those words, frightened woman, trembling. You see a pattern that's happening here in people's response to Jesus. There's this fear, this I'm terrorized by this, or I'm afraid. And here she is, and she falls down before Jesus. And Jesus says, as you got to highlight this too, he tells her, your suffering is over. Remember, chronic infirmity. And he says, your suffering is over. And so I tell you today, Jesus has control over chronic infirmity and pain. Some of us sitting today here in this room or an auditorium too, or maybe you're at home, and you're going, wait, could that be true? Jesus has control over chronic infirmity and pain. Heather, you know that, don't you? Yeah. Incredible testimony. We'll hear about it. Things that the world said, no, that's what you are. Doctors might even make it worse, but this is what you're going to live with. Jesus has control. And then that brings us to the two pieces of bread of the sandwich, the fourth desperate situation. Jairus, who is a synagogue ruler, and his little girl is dying. She's 12 years old. Do we have any 12-year-old girls in our auditorium today? I'm guessing we don't in auditorium too, but anyone 12 years old, just raise your hand. Okay, so right over here. Yeah, and she's hiding. That's a 12-year-old, yeah. So everyone look at her, you know. Okay, so let's move from the story to the real life. What's happening here? His daughter is dying, and this man comes to Jesus, and he's desperate, and he says to Jesus, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and lay your hands on her, heal her so she can live." Can you sense the desperation in this man's heart and in his life, the emotion that's there? He cares about his daughter. He doesn't want her to die. And Jesus says, "Sure, I'll go with you." And while they're on the way, we have this sandwich thing happening, and the woman who's bleeding in her desperate situation. And I can just imagine Jairus, he's saying, "Come on, Jesus, let's get going here, you know." And then messengers come from his house. And they come to say, "It's too late. You don't need to bother the teacher anymore." And the New Living Translation tells us that Jesus overheard them, but perhaps a better translation would be Jesus ignored them. He ignored what they were saying. And he says to this father to not be afraid, but to have faith. And to understand what faith means there, what Jesus is saying to him is, "Trust me. Trust me." And so they go to the man's house. Jesus takes just three of his disciples with them. And already at the house, there's all this commotion, weeping and wailing. And Jesus says to them, "Why all this commotion and weeping? The child isn't dead. She's only asleep." And what did people do? They laughed at him. Take your highlighter. Go there. We're looking at people's response to Jesus. In verse 40, the crowd laughed at him. And we know the story. You heard it read. Jesus goes into the room with his disciples, with mom and dad. And there's this little girl laying there on the bed. That's what they do with the dead body. They laid it out. And he takes the dead girl's hand and says to her in Aramaic, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, get up." And she did. She's raised from the dead. And now look at the reaction, the parents and the people there. They laughed at Jesus. And now it says they were overwhelmed and totally amazed. And so I'm here to tell you that Jesus has control over death. Jesus has control over death. Here's what we know about Jesus in desperate situations. When we face tragedy, maybe it's a tornado or a car accident or potential harm that comes our way, Jesus is supreme. When we face demons, whether in others or in strongholds in our own lives where we no longer have control, Jesus is supreme. When we face chronic infirmity and pain and we despair, Jesus is supreme. When we face the death of someone we love and others are saying, "It's no use, don't bother Jesus with it," Jesus is supreme. In fact, that's the big idea today. Jesus is supreme. I don't know what Jesus you've heard about or that you've believed in, but when I read chapter 5 of Mark, I discover that Jesus is supreme. He's not just a good guy that walked on the earth and had some great sayings and teachings or whatever. He is supreme. These four stories that are given to us here at the end of chapter 4 and then chapter 5 of Mark, they address four areas of desperation and fear that we all struggle with. Come on, admit it. Come on, some of you youth, you're afraid of the dark. There's monsters under your bed. Yeah, you know? And mom and dads too. Here are four areas we fear. It's the fear of tragedy. What if something happens? I can't control it. And it could hurt me or drown me or change my life. Number two, fear of demons. And boy, Hollywood really milks that one, and they send out all these movies trying to scare the wits out of everyone, and dabble in the occult and demonic things. And there's a fear of demons, and there's the fear of chronic infirmity and pain. And those of us who have experienced some of that, you know what I'm talking about. There's this, am I going to be this way always? I don't know if I can live anymore with this. And finally, the fear of death. Either our own death or the death of a loved one. Did you realize from these stories that in every case, those people did everything they could, but it wasn't enough? The disciples, I imagine, were bailing water like crazy, but they knew we're going to drown. The people tried over and over again to bind and subdue that man filled with demons, and they couldn't do it. The bleeding woman had paid for all the medical help she could get to no avail. And the 12-year-old's father did everything he could until there was only Jesus left to turn to. Folks, let's be honest. We are tempted to respond just like they did in Mark, the end of chapter 4 and chapter 5. When we're caught in a tragedy, we, like the disciples, can say to Jesus, "Don't you care? Jesus, don't you care?" When we encounter demons, we're gripped with fear when they lie to us and say, "It's no use. You will never go free." Do we find ourselves withdrawing from others, isolating ourselves, engaging in self-harm, like cutting? That's what this man was doing. When we experience day after day, month after month, year after year, chronic infirmity and pain, and figure it's our lot in life now, and guess what? We'll just have to learn to live with it. Or when we face a parent's worst nightmare, when something threatens the life of their child, and those around us say, "It's no use," and we're tempted to listen to them instead of Jesus. Last Monday, we had a funeral service for one of our dear saints in our church, Waydeen Edgerly. And Pastor Dan is a wonderful pastor, and he spoke at the funeral. And in the middle of his sermon speaking in the funeral, get this, he stopped and he sang a song. And I want you to hear the first words of this song. I'm not going to sing it. I'm going to tell you the words. And I want you to imagine that the disciples and the demonized man and the bleeding woman and Jairus are the ones singing these words. Here it is. "I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus. Since I found in him a friend so strong and true, I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something no other friend could do." This chapter is all about Jesus. It's not about the disciples and the demoniac and the woman and the girl. It's about Jesus. What does this reveal to us about Jesus? Just this: he is supreme. Jesus is supreme. How do we live this out then? What are we supposed to do with this? Remember, we want to know what this is telling us about Jesus, but secondly, we want to live this out now. Well, here are some steps you can take. First off, Mark
5 tells us that the demonized man came and bowed low before Jesus. Did you get that? Jesus comes in the boat. He comes and bows low before him. And then it tells us that the woman with the issue of blood, she fell to her knees in front of Jesus. And then Jairus, this father who's so desperate for his daughter, he came and fell at Jesus' feet. And what I'm suggesting to you is this is a good place for us to start, to fall on our knees before Jesus. You know, every Sunday we open up the front, we have prayer teams up here, and we're going to do it again as we conclude now. And we even have some benches here where you can kneel. Kneeling before Jesus is a great place to start, folks, because he is supreme. And we come and we bow before him. Carrie came up during the worship time, and she was just telling me she felt impressed in her heart. God wants to say to someone here in the service today, it's time. He's going to take you out of darkness and bring you into light. And if that's you here today, I want you to hear what the Spirit's saying to your heart. You don't have to keep living in darkness. Why? Because Jesus is supreme. He could pull you out of darkness and put you into the light. If you've never considered this before about Jesus, you never thought about the fact that he is so great and he's so powerful and he has all authority. He's supreme. Today, I invite you to draw near to the one who is supreme. And I'll invite our worship team to come up, and we're going to sing a chorus in a moment. We're going to respond to this. But today's a great day for you to respond to this Jesus that we read about in Mark chapter 5. If you are in a desperate place in your life, and by the way, some of you sitting here, and some of you in auditorium 2, and some of you online, you are in a desperate place in your life. You just don't know what to do. You've tried everything. And you've reached the end of your rope. And it's not chance that you're here today to hear that Jesus is supreme. I invite you to come near to this Jesus that we're reading about in Mark chapter 5. Trust him with your life and experience his supremacy over all. The things Jesus did in Mark 5, he can and he will do them today. Will you trust him? Trust him with your whole heart? Let's just take a moment. Would you close your eyes? And the reason we're closing our eyes is just to help us to focus. If you're here today, you say, wow, Pastor Tim, that's the Jesus I would like to know. That's the Jesus I want to serve. And maybe you've never made that decision before. Maybe you've never opened your heart to this great, powerful, supreme Jesus before. And I'm inviting you today to do that. Or maybe you're here today and you're so caught in your desperate situation as has become the focus of your life. And you're just despairing whether you can ever get free from it. And I invite you also to come to Jesus. All of us go through desperate times sometime. And the word today for you, don't ever forget this, Jesus is supreme. And so here's what I want us to do. Our prayer team, would you please come to the front? The rest of you, would you stand with me now? And in a moment, we're going to sing a wonderful, encouraging song that talks about these various things. But as the worship team begins to sing, I want to invite you, if today you're saying, you know, I want to draw near to Jesus, then I'm going to ask you to step out from where you're standing and come to the front and find one of our prayer leaders up front and let them pray with you. Listen, the disciples, the demoniac, the woman who was bleeding, and the father of that 12-year-old girl, they didn't care what other people thought. They just were going to get to Jesus, and they came and fell at his feet. We can step forward today, and I invite you to do that. If you want to meet Jesus for the first time, today's your day to meet Jesus who is supreme. So as we sing this chorus now, would you come? And if you're desperate, come. Let's meet Jesus here today. worship team, continue to just play in the background. Folks, we serve a God who's so big and he's so great. He is supreme over it all. If you're not experiencing that in your life, today's the day. Welcome that Jesus. Go out today with this sense, wow, my Jesus is supreme. No matter what I'm facing, no matter how desperate my situation is, I've got this Jesus who is over it all. He wants to be in your life if you open your heart to him. And we're going to pray and dismiss here. Those of you who want to linger and pray, you're welcome to do that. But Jesus isn't just in this room, folks. He's just as much in your car when you're going home, and he's at school when you go back to school or at work or at the grocery store. That's the Jesus that we serve. He is holy forever. He is great and mighty. And so, Father, I pray your blessing on your people here today. Lord, those who are in darkness, I pray that you bring them into the light. Those who are desperate for healing, Lord, heal and demonstrate your mighty power. And those, Lord, who are caught, who are bound, who have strongholds in their life, in the name of Jesus, I pray that they would be delivered. And Lord, those who fear death and are afraid of what tragedy might come, I pray that you deliver them because of your presence in their lives. Bless the people of your church. Bless our young people. Lord, may they grow up knowing this Jesus who is supreme. And I commit these people now to you and to your care. And I pray all these things in that mighty and wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Don't forget, pizza with the pastors immediately following the service.
Position.